Hello learners, I, Dr. Manisha Vadva from Department of Education, Aditi Mahavidyalaya, University of Delhi, welcome you to this NIOS studio. Today's topic of presentation is Thematic Organization of Content in EVS. The EVS content is now organized in themes. What does this mean? This presentation will focus on it. The syllabus in EVS have now moved from topics to themes. If I ask you, what do you understand by general science or social studies? What do you study in science or social studies? I am sure you will give me list of topics which you have studied in science and social science. Why? Why do we think of topics? Because we have studied that way. The syllabus developed by NCERT for the primary school in EVS have moved away from topics to themes. So, but in this presentation, we will make sense what are these themes and how this syllabus is organized. When we think of these subjects of science and social science in school, we clearly have in mind some body of knowledge and also some typical ways of acquiring that knowledge that are associated with each of these. These school subjects have evolved. They have evolved through their own complicated histories and are today quite different from the way sciences or social sciences are practiced in real world. For an integrated approach, syllabus does not proceed with list of topics from different subjects, but instead new themes are given, are mentioned in the syllabus, which allow for connected and interrelated understanding of the concepts. This requires moving beyond traditional boundaries of disciplines and looking at priorities in a shared way. Content is organized not as list of topics, but content is organized as theme. Each theme has few sub-themes, and these sub-themes are organized in a spiral and progressive manners with emphasis on integration. The sub-themes allow for a connected and interrelated understanding to develop. These are the themes which are given in the syllabus of EVS for primary classes. Theme number one is family and friends. Theme number two is food. Theme number three, shelter. Four, water. Five, travel. Six, things we make and do. So these themes, 1 to 6, these are all, I will say that these are not topics, these are themes. And under these themes, there are a list of questions, what all students will learn under these things. You will see that all these themes are close to our life. First, family and friends, food, shelter, water, travel, and things we make and do. So all these things make our life. This theme on family and friends is divided into sub-themes. Sub-themes of relationships, sub-theme of work and play, animals and plants. Plants and animals are consciously included under the theme of family and friends to highlight how humans share a close relationship with them and to also provide a holistic and integrated scientific and social scientific perspective of studying them. These themes in syllabus do not begin by listing of key concepts, but rather key questions which allow each child to think, apply and develop her own understanding and articulate their own learning and ideas. Thematic approach helps to bring in perspectives from different subjects and disciplines. The thematic structuring of the content is visualized to help the child locate herself in a larger context, in a larger context of community, in a larger context of country. It is integrated in nature. It is proposed in the syllabus that themes will allow for a connected and interrelated understanding of different aspects of environment, whether it is a natural environment or socio-cultural environment. The thematic organization also brings in a concept of mutual dependence of self with others and natural environment, providing child with a holistic perspective of environment and the planet Earth, which we share with all other living organisms. The content of theme is derived from child's own experiences rather than a perspective, prescriptive body of knowledge of the subject. These are presented based on child's encounters in her or his daily life. Starting with these personal experiences, children easily connect and build linkages with theoretical knowledge. Now, going beyond the themes, the syllabus format is the following. Now, the syllabus has four things. One is a question, other is the key concepts or issues, third is suggested resources, and fourth is activities. I will explain these using some examples. But before that, you know, when I say questions, so instead of topic, questions are given. And after questions, key concepts are given. Then for those key concepts, what will be the suggested resources and what will be the suggested activities? It will be clear when we'll take an example. We are taking example from class 4, theme family and friend. The question, this is taken from the syllabus given by NCERT. The topic is special occasion. So under the special occasion, in the theme family and friends, these are the questions which are mentioned in the syllabus. The questions are, when do many people eat together? What food is eaten? Who cooks it? How is it served? Did you get a midday meal in school? What items? Who provide the midday meal? So if you read these questions carefully, you will see that these questions, these are, you know, thinking based questions. These questions encourage children to think. They are acting like a scaffold. They are encouraging them to think. Now, after questions, what are the key concepts in it? Key concept is community eating, midday meal if applicable, cultural diversity in foods, associated with special occasions like festivals, family celebrations, ceremonies, and boarding school also. In boarding school also, we eat together. Now, what are the suggested resources for this? Resources like visit to a langar or other such places or occasion, talking to people who cook on such occasions, and narratives about hostel, food, pantry car of a train. And what will be the suggested activities given in the syllabus? Discussion on occasions at which there is community eating, listing of different food eaten at different occasion, drawing and description of large utensils used on such occasions. So you see that in the syllabus, under all themes, there are these questions, key concepts, suggested resources, and suggested activities. If you go through the document, it is a detailed document of class 3, class 4, class 5, and each topic, each theme is mentioned, is taken in great detail. Here in this presentation, it will not be possible to take all the syllabus, but I will be taking some selected portions. This NCERT syllabus has an enabling format, which indicates key themes and sub-themes along with their possible connections. It consciously begins with key questions rather than key concepts, which can trigger child's thinking in new direction and scaffold her learning. It also indicates how adults can stimulate and actively support children's learning, rather than restricting it, as often happen when children are forced to memorize information they just cannot understand. Taking an example from theme shelter of class 3, mapping my neighborhood, just go through these questions and think, you know, how interesting these questions are. How big is your school? What kind of a building is it? Can you draw a picture of your school and your classroom? So in class 3, they are asking children to draw a picture of their school and classroom. Do you know your way around your neighborhood? Can you explain to someone how to reach the post office or the bus stand from your house? So shelter and again mapping the neighborhood. So they are giving an idea how to map their house, how to draw a route from house to bus stand or any other place in the neighborhood. Then moving further in the same sub theme in class 4, questions are like this: who are your neighbors? Do you have any of the following near your house? A school, a grocery shop, market, well, river or pond? Where are they with respect to your house? So giving a sense of direction. So mapping is going by this way. In the class 3, they have asked children to draw, and now in class 4 they are asking with relative positions. I can say mapping begin in class 3 through a basic two-dimensional representation of their classroom, so that by the time they reach class 5, they can read and draw simple aerial views of their locality or city. Moreover, in class 3, they are introduced to a map of Agra with familiar icons, with a narrative which describes experience of two children visiting the city. This story helps children to relate to the abstract iconic map and to look for locations described. In another example of theme travel in class 5, see the kind of questions which are asked on sub-theme ride on a spacecraft. What do you see in the sky at daytime? What do you see in the sky at nighttime? How many of things that you see in a sky are man-made? Have you heard of people traveling in a spacecraft? So you see that we are in syllabus, we are talking of travel, not as means of transport. Why do you think we have shifted from travel to means of transport? Yes, you're right. This theme on travel is more holistic. The theme on travel in syllabus was developed specially to help the child on a journey of ideas of expanding social and physical spaces into newer and unfamiliar terrain of often mind-boggling and no less fascinating diversity. In class 3 and class 4, children are encouraged to look at their own journeys, if any, and to see how older people in their family may have traveled in earlier times. They also read accounts of how people travel today in a desert, through forest, in the hills or in big cities. Moreover, it suggests a story as a resource to bring into classroom the experiences of a child of a migrating family and the problems she face in the process of her schooling. Schools could use stories, posters, plays, films, visits and other media as resources. In class 5, the theme travel takes children through rough and tough terrain of Himalayas with the story of Bachendri Pal, who hoists the national flag after a difficult expedition while they are encouraged to design a flag of their own school. The theme also takes them on a ride of a spacecraft into space, from where for the first time they see the aerial view of the Earth. The syllabus web moves outward over these 3 years, class 3, class 4 and class 5, and gradually extends child's understanding of her world, beginning from immediate self to include her family, then moving on to neighborhood and locality, and then to the country. Thus, by the time the child reaches class 5, she is able to see herself or himself in a larger context as part of a community, as part of a country, and also as located in this world. Indeed, in some flights of fancy, the syllabus even encourage children to think about ride on a spacecraft and the leap beyond the earth into the outer space that may yet not be comprehensible but is certainly fascinating for her. Thus, for instance, the theme on food in class 3 begins with cooking, eating in the family, and about what we eat and what others eat, what animals eat. It then moves in class 4 to how food is grown, what different plants they may have seen, how food reaches us, while staying grounded to the reality of our own pangs of hunger or the plight of people who do not get food. In When Food Gets Spoiled, in this chapter, When Food Gets Spoiled, explores spoilage, preservation of food, while changes in food habits and crops grown are analyzed through the experiences of elder. In class 5, children discuss who grows it, the hardships farmers may face. And finally, in class 5, in this theme food, children read our mouth, taste, and even how we digest food. So how saliva makes food tastier, sweet on chewing, while food for plants also introduce the idea of some curious insect-eating plants. So in short, I can say that EVS must deal with real issues, whether it is of water or of food, by connecting these to children's real experiences of water and food, which are vastly varied. Whose concept of water do we talk about? The child who walks miles across the desert to take a bucket of water, or one who has her house swept away by flood every year? So we are talking about which child? If a person suffers from waterborne disease, so is it an alarming thing? Yes, it is. So water for each child is represented in a different way. EVS in this way is also discusses the issues of dirty water, how to boil water. So it must address with empathy children's real world experience, whether what child affected by a flood, whether child has to travel a lot to take a bucket of water, whether child has a person affected by waterborne disease. So water for each child is a different meaning. So the EVS syllabus addresses with empathy the child's real world of experience to understand some reasons behind the supply of dirty water, sources of contamination, and some issues of gender, caste, and class that determine how water relates to illness. There is often a feeling that perhaps primary children are too young to understand these issues. But no, most of the children live these issues. They live in these situations. They have deeper insights. Probably some have even deeper insights than us about themselves, about their reality. So others who may live in the protected environments also need to understand water, that it is not just what flows through a purifying filter or at the press of a flush button, or that conserving water or living with water scarcity is indeed much more challenging than making posters or giving a routine answers. So in this session, we have seen that EVS content is organized in a thematic manner. I have made this chart showing that how water can be looked from different water can be, you know, seen from different perspectives. Water from a natural science perspective, you know, forms of water, properties of water. From a social science perspective or a cultural perspective, we can think water, you know, as festivals, which festival how water is used, or water related festivals like Chhath Puja. Then we can also trace historical and geographical perspectives of water. We can talk about water resources available in different parts of the countries. We can also understand socio-economic perspective of water. How, you know, certain people from certain classes or certain castes were not allowed to go to certain wells in some parts of the country. Then we have to see the environmental perspective, that we should talk about, we should know and understand real issues related to water conservation, water preservation, and issues related to water pollution and how industries are polluting water. Then also biological and health issues, where we are talking about waterborne diseases. So in a way, you can see that this web chart or thematic chart summarizes what we have undergone, what we have understood in this presentation, that all these themes are interrelated, all these themes are essential part of our lives, and all these themes give us an insight into the experiential knowledge of each child. So I hope with this presentation you have understood that this NCERT syllabus for class 3 to 5 is organized under six main themes and these themes are linked to life. These themes are also linked to each other in a spiral way and come back. The syllabus also suggested a format where instead of topics there are themes, there are questions. Then for those questions there are suggested key concepts, then suggested resources and suggested activities. I hope this presentation will help you in understanding the thematic organization of the EVS syllabus, and I thank you for attending this session and see you in the next session. Thank you.